I should like to call your attention this evening to the message of that eighth psalm which we read together at the beginning, and particularly this evening, the question asked in the fourth verse. Especially, I say, the message of the fourth and the following verses. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passeth through the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Fortnight ago we were looking at this psalm, and I put it to you in this form, that here we seem to have a man describing something with which we are very familiar at this present time. Here is a man looking up into the heavens, looking at the moon and the stars, and all that is there to be seen, and who reports his observations and tells us of the conclusions at which he arrived. Now I say, this psalmist of old was doing something that large numbers of people are doing at the present time. We are all being made to look up into the heavens. We've all developed a new interest in the moon and the stars and in outer space. Our newspapers are full of these things, and it is the topic of conversation. We are hearing about it on the wireless. The whole attention of mankind seems to be focused upon the heavens. But here is the vital question. What do we see as thus we are looking at the heavens? What is the message of all this to us? What are the conclusions at which we arrive as the result of all this? It isn't just enough to look. The whole question is, what do we see? Everybody can look, but the whole art of life is not to look but to see. There's a difference between seeing and perceiving. So that the significant thing is the report which we give after we have looked, or if you like, the conclusions at which we arrive as the result of our contemplation of the heavens. Now, here this man tells us about his conclusions, and the point I'm making is that his conclusions are obviously and patently so different from the conclusions arrived at by the vast majority of people at this present time. Indeed, the tragic thing is this, that modern man who doesn't view things and who doesn't believe as this psalmist believed and as all Christians still believe, the man who doesn't believe these things, looking at the heavens, misses the most important things of all. What are they? Well, God and himself. That is the very essence of the modern predicament and of the modern tragedy. Here is something, it seems to me, that needs therefore our most urgent and careful attention at a time such as this. What is being praised and lauded today, of course, above everything else, is what is described as the scientific outlook. This is the thing on which modern man prides himself and in which he glories. This is to him the highest mark of his emancipation and of his advance, that he is able to view the whole of life in this scientific manner. Now let nobody misunderstand me. It would be folly, sheer folly, to denounce scientific study. There's not only nothing wrong in that, there's everything right about it. But what does become serious, and the thing to which we must address our attention is this, is the exaltation of the scientific method into a philosophy of life. The claim that what is done in the material realm through science is something which can be done also to cover the whole of life. Now, that is the thing which I am here to suggest to you is not only wrong, but leads to the real inner meaning of the tragedy and the predicament of our modern world. Here, I say, is the thing then that is exalted, this supposed scientific outlook. I say supposed for this reason, that the moment any scientist or any man who has scientific knowledge goes beyond the realm of things which he can measure and estimate and with which he can experiment and confirm his theories, the moment he goes beyond that, he has, strictly speaking, ceased to be a scientist and has become a philosopher and is speculating. And it is when he begins to do that in the name of science that I think he produces the modern kind of tragedy. Because, as I've already reminded you, in doing that, he shuts out the two most important and the two most significant things of all. I was trying to show a fortnight ago that the result of this is that he only sees brute facts, as it were. He looks up into the heavens, he sees nothing but moon and stars and things of that kind, and no more. He misses the immaterial. He misses that which is most glorious, that which is most wonderful, that which is most thrilling. He has so concentrated upon certain aspects only that he misses the real splendor and marvel and glory of it all. Now, this is a very real thing. If you read the autobiography of Charles Darwin was undoubtedly a great man and a great scientist. But you know what Charles Darwin tells us in his autobiography. He tells us that as the result of his lifetime of concentration upon certain aspects only of life, he tells us that the result of that was that at the end of his life, he had lost completely his appreciation of the beauty of nature. Now, at one time, he had an appreciation of the beauty of nature. But he'd so concentrated on the material, on the specimens, on the fossils, on these pure facts, as it were, he'd so concentrated on that, that when he beheld a wonderful landscape, he could no longer appreciate it. He tells us that in the same way, he had lost his appreciation of music and of poetry. He no longer could respond to great music, nor to great poetry. At the beginning, he could, but he somehow or another, in concentration on material facts, had lost this sense, this ability to enjoy and to appreciate things belonging to those other realms. Now, I'm suggesting that that is what is happening to mankind in general at this present hour, that we have become so immersed in these purely scientific discoveries and in this purely scientific knowledge that we are being blinded to the higher values, to the highest values, and to the things that are of lasting and of final significance with respect to life and living. There was in an evening newspaper only this week a most interesting article which some of you may have read by a very distinguished surgeon in which he said very much what I'm trying to say now and what I was saying a fortnight ago. There is a man whom I don't think would claim to be a Christian, but he at any rate says this quite plainly, that this purely scientific outlook is really totally inadequate as a view of life. It doesn't take in love. It hasn't any place for love and the higher and the finer emotions. These things by which we live, it can't account for them, and it isn't interested in them. It's purely scientific, and there it concentrates on that, and it shuts out the things that which I believe we would all agree, which truly make life worth living and make life wonderful and make life glorious. Well, thus I say, modern men, by his concentration on facts only, on sun and moon and stars only, misses God and even misses the wonder and the truth, even concerning himself. Now, last fortnight ago, we dealt with the first aspect, how men misses the glory of God. He sees moon and stars, he doesn't see God at the back of them. The God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is mindful of men and who has visited men. He can just look and see facts, even as the people in the lifetime of our Lord here on earth looked at him and saw just a man and a carpenter and didn't see the glory of God shining through. Now that is, I say, supreme tragedy. But this evening, I want to concentrate on this second aspect, which is that man, in the same way, misses the truth with respect to himself, and especially with respect to his own true greatness and glory. Now, in other words, to put it in a different form, surely the great question that is arising at the present hour is the question put here by the psalmist. What is man? Isn't that the question? What is man? What are we? What is the truth about us? What are we doing in this world? What is this world? What's happening in it? Yes, more important perhaps, what's going to happen to it? With all these tremendous things that are taking place, where do we come in? What is it all about? What's it leading to? What's it meant to be? What is man? That's the question. But I think you'll agree that in general the question isn't even being considered, because we're all concentrating on phenomena, and we are missing this point. We are not asking this question. And even when, for various reasons, we do ask it, as I'm going to try to show you, we give the wrong answer to it. Surely there is no more urgent question than this, my dear friend. Haven't you come to feel that? Aren't you beginning to ask, well, what has all this got to say to me? I'm involved in all this. What's it telling me about myself? What am I? What's going to happen to me? What's my destiny? Surely the problem is extremely urgent. The newspapers are telling us that. The writers are telling us that. The scientists of all people are telling us that. As they put it, if some lunatic suddenly has his finger on the trigger, as it were, with these tremendous possibilities, well, the end may come. Well, doesn't that immediately raise this question? Who am I? What will happen to me if that does happen? What is man? Now then, my contention is that there is only one true and adequate answer to that question. And it is the answer that is given in this psalm, as it is the answer that is given in the whole of the Bible everywhere. What is man in the light of all this? Well, now, I say, when you look, as we must first of all look at the modern, non-Christian, non-biblical answers to that question, we find ourselves faced with utter confusion, faced with a contradiction. I mean by that the answers that are given to the question as to what man is are utterly contradictory. And mankind, therefore, is in a state of complete confusion at this present time. I don't want to go into this in too much detail. Let me just put it hurriedly in this form. I think I'm right when I say that there are two main tendencies to be seen very clearly in this answer given by the modern, scientific, so-called, non-Christian men to this question, what is meant. The first tendency is the tendency to overestimate men. You are familiar with this. It works itself out something like this. It says, well, now, of course, we are looking up there into the heavens, and we are now able to make these statements about the moon and the stars. Our forefathers didn't know anything about it. They'd got their little views, but of course by now we know, and we can talk about these millions of light years and so on, and these billions and trillions of distances. We've made these marvelous discoveries. As the result of our scientific investigations, we are able to speak about that outer space. Not only that, now we're even able to send these things up into that outer space, these satellites, and so on. And they say there's only one conclusion to come to as the result of all this. That man is a very marvelous and a very wonderful creature. Is there anything indeed that is not possible to man? Here he is able to do these astounding things that were unthinkable in the past. Actually sending up a satellite which has been going round and round in that outer space. Man succeeded in doing that. He'll probably land something like that onto the moon fairly soon. Man's evidently able to control everything. Billions and trillions mean nothing to him. He's so endowed with faculties and propensities and powers. He's got everything under his hands. Man, he's a colossus. Man, why, he must be something of a god. At any rate, he's so wonderful that we have no need of a god. Our forefathers, in their ignorance, of course, they looked up and they thought that the heavens were just a short distance above them and that they might fall on them at any moment. So naturally, with that kind of mentality and in that sort of ignorance, they believed in a great God at the back of it all. But man no longer believes in God because he has no need to believe in God. With his telescopes and his ability to see to the ends of the earth and to cause things to land at any point he likes at a given moment, there's no need of a God. There's no need of a God because man is man, and because man is so wonderful. Man, he comes to the conclusion as the result of all that he knows and has discovered and all he sees when he looks up into the heavens. He says, I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. Why, man, there's no limit to him. With his ability to do these things, it's only a matter of time before he'll be able to perpetuate life. There'll be no end to life. It'll go on forever and ever. He'll conquer. Of course, he's bound to. A man who can do what man is doing now, he's going to conquer all diseases. He'll have drugs to destroy every germ. There's no disease possible, but that man will deal with it. He'll discover the secret of perpetual living, perpetual motion. He'll get rid of everything that tends to destroy life, and he'll go on living forever and forever. There's no limit to man. Man! How wonderful is man, so wonderful that the idea of a god is an insult to him. That's one view. You're familiar with it. The overestimate of men. But you see, quite interesting, extraordinarily interesting, as a matter of fact, at exactly the same time there is a tendency on the part of others to underestimate men. And this is rarely very common also at this present time. These people look up into the heavens at the sun and the moon and the stars and these immensities and infinities and these extraordinary distances. And they say, what is man? What is man? When you begin to look at things like this, he's just a speck. He's just a little particle. Man, insignificant. What does he count? Man, well, he's just somebody that's, or something that is subject to these great processes. You see, we are discovering, they say, these wonderful laws that are governing all these things and the movements of those bodies up there in the heavens and how they're suspended and all that happens. And what is man? Well, he's just the same sort of thing, they say, in a different way. What is man? Well, they say, man, we've discovered, is nothing but a gathering and an agglomeration of various biological forces and powers. There we are dealing with other kinds of forces and powers. Man is just, a mass of biological forces and powers, ductless glands, giving out their secretions. And they say, man is just a kind of mechanism that's determined absolute. As those things are determined by their laws, so man is determined by these laws, biological, nothing more. Or he is merely economic. There are those who hold quite seriously that man is nothing but the result of the interplay of economic forces and factors, and that you can explain the whole of history purely in the terms of economics. Others say that man is to be explained as the plaything and the resultant of historical forces in a wider sense. But they all come to this conclusion, that man is really small and insignificant, that in this great atomic age, man really is unimportant altogether. With all these advances, what's an individual? What's man? Cannon fodder. Just a mass of flesh, a lump of humanity. Oh, it's these big things that matter, and there they are, hovering over us and around and about us. And what is man? He's nothing at all. He seems to be utterly trivial and irrelevant almost in the midst of these infinities and immensities. Oh, I mustn't keep you. Let me put it to you in those words of Shakespeare in Macbeth, putting it perfectly. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty space from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage, and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. Shakespeare has become contemporary, hasn't he? The sound and the fury, and the rockets and the bombs and the explosions. Terrific! What is it? What's it signifying? Nothing. Nothing. Tale told by an idiot. All our tomorrows and all our yesterdays and all the fuss and pother, what is it all? Life's but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and makes his marvelous discoveries and gets excited about them, and then the final explosion and he's gone. Nothing. End. Death. Destruction. Cessation of being. Full of sound and fury, but signifying nothing. Now, it's interesting, isn't it, that at one and the same time, you get these two views of men at the present time, this hopeless overestimate of men and this hopeless underestimate of men, because I'm here to remind you this evening that both those descriptions are quite wrong. And they're wrong because they're partial. They've got an element of truth in them, both of them. Yes, but because each one says it's the whole truth, they're both entirely wrong. That's the whole trouble today, that we're taking partial views. And because we are seeing things partially and exaggerating that to the whole, we are altogether wrong. Very well, then, what is the truth about men? What's the biblical view of men? Well, here it is, in this eighth psalm. Now, this eighth psalm is a very fascinating psalm. Let's remind ourselves that first and foremost, it is a description of man himself. But it's more than that. It is indirectly and in a secondary sense a prophecy concerning the Lord Jesus Christ and his incarnation, as that passage in the second chapter of the Epistle to the Hebrews, which I read at the beginning, reminded us so perfectly. And it's right, the psalm is both Primarily, it is a description of men. And the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, became man. It then applied to him. But wait a minute, let's look at it properly. What does it tell us? Well, I want to suggest to you that it really does give us the only answer to the modern question, what is man? It is the only thing that gives us a glimmer of hope with respect to ourselves in this world tonight. Let me divide it up hurriedly like this. First of all, listen to what it's got to tell us about man as he was originally. Man as he was created at the beginning. And what does he say? Here it is. What is man? The answer is, thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. What is this a reference to? Well, this is just his way of putting what you have there in the very first chapter of the book of Genesis. Do you remember what we are told? In the first chapter and verse 26, and God said, let us make men in our image, after our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created men in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Now that is what this man is repeating. It is the fundamental teaching of the Bible from beginning to end with regard to men. He puts it here in this interesting phrase. Thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. There are those who say that it should be translated like this. Thou hast made him just short of divinity. And I believe that is right. Thou makest him want but a little of God. Thou hast made him a little lower than thyself, a little lower, just short of divinity. Man, according to the psalmist, as he was originally made, had an almost, but not quite, super-earthly dignity. All right, we can take the translation as it is here. Thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. What does this mean? Well, there it is. Man is made in the image of God. But what does that mean, says someone? Well, let me define it for you. To say that man is made in the image of God means that there is that in man which differentiates him and distinguishes him from the beasts. It means all those faculties and principles of human nature whereby man is capable of moral agency. Now then, what do I mean by that? Well, let me subdivide it in this way. Man has a soul and a spirit. One of the characteristics of man is his spirituality. That means that God made men for communion with himself. When God made men in his own image, it means that God made men in such a way that he could converse with him, speak with him, have a conversation with him, live in fellowship with him, in a way that cannot be true of animals. He made him in his own image, with that likeness of himself, with a spirituality corresponding to God's own spiritual nature. God is spirit. And man was given a spiritual side of his nature. It means that. But man has also been given what you may call, if you like, a psychical nature. And this is also a part of the image of man. The image of God in man. Because here is the thing that differentiates man from the animals. Man in his psychical being has been given an intellect and a will. And they function, as you know, in these ways. Because of our intellects, we are able to be self-conscious. There is no evidence at all that any animal has ever had self-consciousness, but man is self-conscious. Man has power to reason and to think. He has power to contemplate himself and to analyze himself. Now, no animal has ever had that power. That's a part of God's image in man. This is a part of man's psychical makeup. You see, you and I are able to look on at ourselves. We are able to ponder ourselves, to meditate upon ourselves. We can criticize ourselves. We can analyze ourselves. We can contemplate self. That's a part of the divine image in men. This psychical nature, this intellectual power, and this power of will that goes with it. Indeed, I agree with those who say that a part of God's image in men is seen in man's body. Man, you see, doesn't go on all fours. He's upright. God made man upright to stand on his feet. That is a part of God's image in men seen even in the body. The very uprightness of the body is indicative of the fact that man is meant, as we are told here, to be the Lord of creation. He looks down upon the animals, upon the creation. He is in a position of lordship over them. And therefore, the next thing to emphasize is this dominion that God gave to men over the earth and over creation. But added to all this and above and beyond it all, when God made man at the beginning, he not only put all those powers into him and those propensities, he made him perfect. He gave man a moral excellency and a moral perfection. Man, as he came out of the hands of God, was absolutely perfect. He was without sin. He was without any blemish. He was without anything that detracted from the perfection of God's work in him. That is man made in the image of God. Now we must hold on to this. That's man. Man is not a creature that has evolved out of some primitive slime. Man is not the result of some fortuitous accidental meeting of some great powers and forces, of some electrons. Man is not merely the result of some biological processes. No, no. He's got all that in him, but he's over and above that. Man's person, spiritual, psychic, with these astounding powers and faculties. And for man to deny that is to insult his own nature and his own being. We all know that these things are true. There then is man as he was made originally. He's not arriving at something. That's how he started. But wait a minute, that leads us to the second question. You say, if that is man, he most certainly isn't that now. And I entirely agree. And the Bible agrees. You see, the Bible puts it in three pictures. Man as he was, man as he is, man as he yet can be. Oh, thank God for this. We are not left in darkness, my friends. You needn't accept either of these modern theories because you find that each one is inadequate. You see, there is this contradiction which they don't explain, as I'm going to show you. But wait a minute, let's look at man as he is. What do we find? Well, it's very interesting. The psalmist used an interesting word here. Looking at the heavens, he says, "What is man?" And the word he used is a word that implies a sense of weakness and a sense of frailty. You see, this man living so many thousands of years ago and without the Jodrell Bank telescope was able to see tremendous things because having seen them, he said, "What is man?" The smallness, the frailty, the weakness of man. Man, rather than being the Lord and Master of creation, doesn't he seem to be mastered by it? Man controlling nature? Man can only get his food by the sweat of his brow and spends most of his time in keeping down thorns and weeds and briars. He's up against a tremendous power that's always threatening to overwhelm him. Man, a Lord and Master? He seems the very reverse. Standing upright, Lord, no, cowering, wondering what's going to happen and when it's going to happen, when it's going suddenly to fall upon him. unhappy, frightened, frustrated, bewildered. Man made in the image of God. Is he? You come to that conclusion as you read your Sunday newspapers, especially some of them, and all the details of what's happening in the courts, and all these crimes of violence, and all the license, moral and immoral. Is that man? Is this the creature made in the image of God, the unworthy living, the foulness, the vileness, the perversions? Man, of whose knowledge we boast so much, why doesn't he know how to live them? Why doesn't he harness this knowledge? If he knows so much and is so marvelous and so wonderful, why is he living almost like swine? What's the matter with men? Look at him, there it is, and that is how he lives. He makes these great discoveries. Yes, but as he makes them, the main result seems to be that he is threatening his own destruction and the destruction of his own world. We admit the science is marvelous. We admit that the feat is tremendous. Yes, but what's it going to lead to? We've got all this knowledge, but why can't we harness it? Why can't we use it? Why can't we apply it? Why this sense of doom? Doesn't it all seem to be our master rather than we the master of it? And the whole of creation seems to be in trouble. That is man as he is, isn't it? Why is this? Well, you see, the Bible alone can answer that question. Man is as he is, it says, and the world is as it is because after God made him in his own image and made him perfect, man fell. Man sinned. Man turned his back upon God and rebelled against him. And the result of that is man as we see him today, man as he is in the world at this moment. And that is why man is such a contradiction. And that is why, you see, I said just now that there are elements of truth in both the modern descriptions of men. It's no use saying that man is just an insignificant fool and that life is a tale told by an idiot. Not at all. The very achievements of men give the lie direct to that. But you see, it's equally wrong to say that man is a colossus who can do anything he wants to do, because he patently cannot. Man is a fool. Man's a genius and a fool at the same time. He goes up into the heavens and then he goes down into the depths. He displays this amazing capacity. And yet he lives as if he hadn't an atom of sense anywhere in his being. He's a mass of contradictions. Why? Well, it's just because of this, you see. When man fell, the image was not entirely destroyed. The image of God in man didn't go out of existence altogether when man fell. No, no, there are remnants and relics left. And these are the things that make man wonderful still. Ah, yes, but he lost the greatest things of all. He lost the fellowship and the communion with God. He lost his spiritual susceptibility. He lost his knowledge. He lost his uprightness. He lost his sense of justice and of truth. And he became the slave of sin and of evil and of iniquity. And not only did he fall himself, he dragged down creation with him. Because as the apostle says, the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Nature red in tooth and claw. The clash, the threats, the terrible and dread possibilities. What is the explanation of all this? Well, you see, it's just this. Man has brought all this upon himself by his sin. He's brought upon himself the wrath and the curse of God. My dear friend, if you don't believe that, you'll never believe the gospel. You can't. It is because of this that the gospel comes in. God has told men that he will punish him if he disobeys, and man is being punished. He has brought the punishment upon himself. His life is a life of contradictions. It's uncertain. It's unhappy. It's frustrated. It's miserable. He thinks he's about to lift himself out of it. He always finds himself in a worse predicament. The more we know, the more uncertain life has become. The more we conquer diseases, the more we are frightened by the atomic power. The more you cure one disease, another disease comes in. And so man goes on, round and round in circles, and a mass of contradictions. That, says the Bible, is man as he is. There is man as he was. Here is man as he is. Oh, thank God I can go on. That isn't the end of the story. And that isn't the end of the story because of the gospel. Because of the Christian message. Because of the message of salvation. See, that's what makes it so tragic that this supposed scientific view of man excludes God and says there isn't a God. Well, all I say, if there isn't a God, what hope is there? Do you see any at all? If there is no God, and man is able to do what he's doing, and man still remains the creature of lust and passion and vice, what's he going to do with the world? There's only one answer. He's going to just smash it and destroy it. And there's no hope. None at all. But if when you look into those heavens and see the sun and the moon and the stars, you see God at the back of it all, you then ask your question, what is man? And what's it all about and what is heaven? And you're given your answer. Oh, yes, God is still there. And though man has brought himself and his world to this present pass and to this present appalling predicament, it isn't the end of the story because God is still there, you know, even beyond outer space, even beyond the reach of the most marvelous rocket a man will ever make, God is still beyond it. He's above it all. He reigneth there in infinity and in eternity. He's over all. Thank God he is there. And you see, he hasn't finished with this world. He's given men considerable liberty in it. When God made men, he made him perfect and he made him free. He gave him absolute free will. And it was because of that man had the possibility of doing what he did and of bringing all the calamity upon himself. Yes, but God's at the back still. And God hasn't left it just to this. This isn't the end of the story of men and the world. The end is not just going to be that some fool, some mad dictator, in his rapacity and in his lust, is suddenly going to pull the trigger and the whole world ends. Not at all. Oh, no. The Lord reigneth still. And he hasn't left this process without intervening. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What's it mean? It means just this, that God has sent his only Son into this world. Did you notice how that author of the Epistle to the Hebrews puts it in that second chapter? Christ, he says, was also made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. You talk about man and his achievements. Look at this. The everlasting and eternal Son of God who had dwelt eternally in that eternal bosom came down on earth to dwell, entered into the virgin's womb. My dear friends, you see, we are looking at things the wrong way around. We are looking from earth up to heaven. The mightiest thing that's ever happened is when heaven came down to earth. It's a marvelous thing, I'm not detracting from it, to be able to send up these missiles from earth up into outer space. But listen to this, from heaven, the heaven of heavens, down into the virgin's womb, came the substance of the eternal substance. God, the everlasting Son. He became a little lower than the angels. Why? Oh, I'll tell you why. In order, again, as that second chapter of Hebrews puts it, to take unto himself human nature. Verily, he says, he has not stretched out a helping hand to angels. No, no. He has stretched out a helping hand unto the seed of Abraham. Because the children were made of flesh and blood, he also himself became likewise partaker of the same. The Son of God didn't become an angel, he became a man. And in him, human nature has been made perfect. You look at him and you see perfect man, again as he is meant to be, man truly in the full image of God. He has triumphed over all sin and evil, over every enemy, and he has conquered all. We see Jesus said that man who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor. And he himself, having conquered death and the grave, and having risen again, said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. Man is marvelous. He's able to send things into outer space. Christ controls the whole of outer space and everything and the whole universe, the entire cosmos, man included. Everything is under his hand. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. He's Lord of men as well as angels. But what has all this got to do with me, says someone. My dear friend, it's this. Do you know why he came and did all that? He came in order that you and I might again be made men, again in the image of God, that we might become like him. That's why he's come. What is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? And the answer of God to the question put by men is this. I made you in my own image. You listen to the devil, mine adversary, and you've marred it, but I'm not going to be defeated. I'm not leaving it at that. I'm going to remake you. And he sent his son. He came and lived and taught and died and rose again and ascended to heaven in order that this might happen to us. He came in order that we might be delivered from the punishment of that our sin so richly deserves. For oh, what fools we are to sin against such a God and pit ourselves against him. It's enormous. It's enormity. Oh, I say, it's a sin that must be forgiven. And there's only one way whereby it can be forgiven, and God has provided that way. He's punished our sin in his own Son, and thereby we can be forgiven. Christ came to deliver us from the guilt of our sins, to deliver us from the power of our sins. He came to give us a new life and a new nature. He came to give us something of his own nature, to make us partakers of the divine nature. In him the tribes of Adam burst more blessings than their father lost. But, my dear friend, it doesn't stop at that. What of the future? Well, the future, according to the Bible, is just this. Christ not only came to forgive us our sins and to give us this new nature and to make us children of God. He came to make us heirs of a world that is yet to come. For not unto angels, says Hebrews again, has he given this world to come of which we speak. To whom then? To man. Oh, my beloved friend, that you and I could see this in this world as it is this evening. We are only seeing sun and moon and stars. We are seeing the dread possibilities and the chaos. This world in which you and I are living is to come to an end. This world is definitely under judgment. This world of sin and of evil and of shame is going to be destroyed. That is as certain as we are here at this moment. Of course, it's not difficult to believe that now, is it? There was a time when people couldn't believe that sort of thing, but everybody can see how it can happen today. If man can pull a trigger and do it, how much more God? This world is going to be destroyed. All evil and sin, everything that is opposed to God and unlike God is going to be punished and destroyed to all eternity. Whether men or whether things, it's all going to be destroyed. And there will be a new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. And there are going to be people who are going to live in that new earth under that new heaven. And they're going to be with Christ and with the holy angels. And they're going to see God. Who are they? Human beings, men and women like you and myself. Ordinary people just like you and me. Yes, but you see, on one condition. And that is that we have received this new nature. That God has done this second work of creation in us. Not otherwise. Because nothing evil and sinful and vile can dwell in the presence of Christ and of God in glory. But that world is coming, that great and perfect world. Who shall live in it and dwell in it and enjoy it? I'll tell you. It is those who realize here and now in this life and in this world that they're sinners. That they're vile, that they're fools, that they're unworthy of God, that they're unworthy of forgiveness and of God's love. They are those who see the folly and the enormity of it all and acknowledge it and confess it unto God and then believe his gospel about his Son, that Jesus of Nazareth was the Son of God and that he came to die for them and redeem them and to purchase their pardon and forgiveness. They are those who turn to him and cast themselves upon his love and mercy and compassion and who give themselves to him and who, forsaking their sins, take up their cross and follow after him. But they are promised of a surety that when the destruction and the end of the world will come, they will be saved, they will be safe. It won't touch them. They'll be beyond it in the safe keeping of the Son of God. And he will bring them with himself and enjoy the new life. In the new creation, in the regeneration of the Son of Man, and when he comes. And they shall be with him to all eternity, and enjoy the glory with him. My dear friend, what of you? Have you asked the question? What is man? What am I? Tell me, do you know that God cares for you? Do you know that God is mindful of you? Here's David of old looking up and seeing the things that you and I are looking at, and he says, what is man, what am I, that you are mindful of me? Or that you visit me? Do you know that the everlasting and eternal God is mindful of you? That it is because he was mindful of you that he sent his Son into this world? Has he visited you? Has Christ visited you? Has Christ come to you? Has Christ entered into your life? The message of the gospel is, I say, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to all that whosoever, doesn't matter who he is, nor what he is, nor what he or she may have done, however black, however vile, it doesn't matter, whosoever believeth in him should not perish. If they don't believe, they will perish, and we know not when it'll come. But whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Have you realized the essential greatness of man? Have you seen the vileness of man as he is in sin? Have you seen yourself made anew in Christ Jesus and an heir of that world that is yet to come?
We do hope that you've been helped by the preaching of Dr. Martyn Lloyd-Jones. All of the sermons contained within the MLJ Trust audio library are now available for free download. You may share the sermons or broadcast them. However, because of international copyright, please be advised that we are asking first that these sermons never be offered for sale by a third party, and second, that these sermons will not be edited in any way for length or to use as audio clips. You can find our contact information on our website at mljtrust.org. That's mljtrust.org.